Okay. Szanowni Państwo, ladies and gentlemen, let me welcome you on this occasion when Poland is celebrating the National Day, the May 3rd Constitution Day. Ladies and gentlemen, please rise for the national anthem of the Republic of Poland. Okay, so the Constitution of 3rd of May has been an achievement of the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth. On the occasion of 230th anniversary of its enactment, the Minister of Foreign Affairs of Poland and Lithuania have prepared their joint address. Let us listen to it now.
Today, Poland and Lithuania, both active members of the EU and NATO, are bound by centuries-old ties. To understand our common past and current strong partnership, we need to look into the history of both states and nations. The Polish-Lithuanian relationship evolved from the Union of Krewo in 1385 to the Union of Lublin in 1569, whose provisions respected separate historical traditions of the Kingdom of Poland and the Grand Duchy of Lithuania. The common state, called the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth, was established under one ruler with a common parliament and a coordinated foreign policy, while armies, treasuries, and other offices were kept separate and different legislation was respected. We believe that the Commonwealth was one of the precursors of the European Union. At the end of the 18th century, the neighboring powers of Austria, Prussia, and Russia came to pose a threat to the weakened Polish-Lithuanian state, unlawfully partitioning it in 1772. As a result, the Commonwealth lost a significant part of its territory. Polish and Lithuanian parliamentarians adopted, during the deliberations of the Great Sejm in 1791, the Governance Act known as the Constitution of 3rd May. This progressive legislation was the world's second after the American one and Europe's first written constitution. It introduced a tripartite separation of powers and reformed the existing political system, ensuring more equal treatment of all nationalities within the Commonwealth.
Adopted on 20th October 1791 by the Joint Sejm, a mutual pledge, two nations was an integral part of the Constitution of 3rd May and an act of utmost importance to the Commonwealth's political system. Equal representation for the Polish and Lithuanian citizens in the common state bodies confirmed a strong union between the two nations. Because of the Russian interference, the Constitution was abolished in 1793, followed by two more partitions. Poland and Lithuania reappeared on the map only in 1918. Recalling these two fundamental legal acts, we can proudly say that the leaders of both states, despite all the differences arising from their history, were able to work together effectively at the moment crucial to their existence. A common history of centuries inspires Warsaw and Vilnius to deepen the strategic cooperation. Today, Lithuania and Poland work together in Europe and in the transatlantic area. We work on important energy and transport projects for the whole of Europe. Together with NATO, we strengthen the international security. We continue to support our neighbors, Ukraine, its sovereignty and territorial integrity. We support civic society in Belarus, striving for freedom and independence. It is a tradition and responsibility arising from our common history.
Thank you. Now, let me give the floor to the Consul General of the Republic of Poland, Mr. Aleksander Dajnda, who will say a few words concerning the way that the Constitution actually came to be. Consul General, please.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, today's celebration commemorates the Constitution that after many, many years of debate, discussions, negotiations, which were carried out by the great Sejm, especially in the years 1788, 1792, those discussions resulted in a national settlement signed on the 3rd of May, 1791. In a few words, let me explain to you what we, the Poles, actually celebrate on that day. We are taking a short trip back in time at the beginning of this presentation. So it is the year 1791. The British Parliament passes the Constitutional Act, which is actually splitting the former province of Quebec into Upper and Lower Canada. The French Revolution is in its third year already, and the National Assembly of France accepts the metric system as the only system of measurement, which later on will be adopted throughout Europe and much of the world. In Berlin, on the very same year, the Brandenburg Gate is finished. In Vienna, Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart dies at his home, aged only 35. In the USA, the newly established capital city is named Washington, D.C., after the incumbent first president of the USA, George Washington. In the very same year, the first 10 amendments to the United States Constitution are ratified, and they create the United States Bill of Rights. In the same year, in Warsaw, the Polish king Stanisław August Poniatowski and some of the nobles supporting him, they are struggling for the political survival of the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth. They feel the pressure of increasing danger from neighboring states of Russia, Prussia, and Austria, who just lie in waiting for taking the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth off the map of Europe. It is the morning of Tuesday, the 3rd of May, and the public galleries and streets around the Royal Castle in Warsaw are packed with expectant crowds. Units of the Royal Guard, commanded by the king's nephew, Prince Józef Poniatowski, they are keeping order. Inside the castle, in the Senate chamber, Stanisław Małachowski, the marshal of the Sejm, or how we would spell it today, the speaker of the lower house of the parliament, he is tapping his marshal's staff to begin the day's proceeding at 11 o'clock. The chamber is not full, maybe not as empty as in the picture, but it is definitely not full, simply because many parliamentarians have not yet returned to Warsaw after the break for Easter. That was actually the reason why the king and his supporters decided to act decisively and swiftly to introduce the new law on the government. Normally, the new legislation projects were supposed to be introduced in the same Polish parliament. They were supposed to be printed and remain in deliberation for at least 3 days before being debated and decided, usually by unanimity. If this unanimity was not forthcoming, projects should be put to a vote. However, there was a substantial number of nobles opposing the proposed changes into the political system of Polish-Lithuanian state, and the authors of the constitutional project could not and would not risk the piece-by-piece destruction of the entire reform package by the deliberation and discussion procedures in the Sejm. Thus, it was decided to introduce the project in the Sejm on the day when many of those opposing the reform were still at home after the Easter celebrations. In the process of the Sejm's session, there is the information from the Parliamentary Deputation for Foreign Affairs. In today's terms, you would say today the information from the Foreign Affairs Standing Committee of the Parliament. This information signals the imminent threat to the nation's existence, and it justifies the abbreviated procedure for the new law. King Stanisław August emphasizes the grave peril for our fatherland. He announces that he had been shown a project which could avert the danger, but even in 2 weeks' time, it might be already too late. There is a cry for the project to be read out. That cry fills the chamber. The project is read and it is applauded enthusiastically. There are still a few dissenting nobles who ensure that a proper debate, although short, but a proper debate is held on the project of the new law. The main point of contention is the point of the new law, which envisages creating the constitutional monarchy, which means the monarchy bound by the laws adopted by the Sejm. But at the same time, this new monarchy would be a hereditary one instead of the elective monarchy as it used to be. Some of the opposing nobles, they argue that the abolition of royal elections will bring about the slavery of the people of the Commonwealth. Those who support the new law, they argue in response that the election of Polish kings, which was started more than 200 years before that event in 1572, that the elections of kings was they were never a prerogative of liberty, but they were always fatal to it. It was always the feast at which the most important and most rich of the nobles, the magnates, made themselves ever stronger for generation upon generation. The true liberty, the supporters of the new legislation say, the true liberty is only when we are able to make the law and we are subject to nothing but the law. The debate finishes at about 6 p.m. The Marshal Małachowski speaks that on this day, which becomes a day of revolution in our government for the salvation of the fatherland, all formalities must be set aside. In extreme danger, it is necessary to reach for extreme medicine. After that, the king, Stanisław August, raises his hand, signaling that he wants to speak. The king's party takes this, however, as a sign that the king is willing to take the oath. The nobles storm towards the throne, and the king, simply seeing that it can be done already, he swears an oath of allegiance to the new constitution. He climbs on a chair so that he can be visible above the crowd in the chamber. He places his left hand on the gospel held by the Bishop of Smolensk and raising his right hand, repeats the words of the oath after the Bishop of Krakow. After swearing the oath of allegiance to the constitution in the Senate chamber, the king leads the great majority of parliamentarians along the street of Warsaw to the nearby church of St. John the Baptist. The marshals of Polish and Lithuanian Sejm are being carried there on the shoulders of the crowd. The monarch, marshals, bishops, senators, envoys, and the public, all of them swear to uphold the new constitution. After that, thousands gathered outside start singing Te Deum Laudamus, Thee, O God, we praise. To the ringing of the bells, the king and parliamentarians return to the Senate chamber where the king asks the marshals to administer taking the oath of allegiance to the constitution for every member of the government and all the soldiers. After the marshals sign the constitution, one of the most important days in Polish history is coming to an end. The constitution itself was brief and it was easy to read, unlike many contemporary documents of that sort. It set out the Commonwealth values, the structure of the new form of the state, and the principal institutions governing it. It left the details for subsequent legislation. The text begins with the invocation and the preamble. Then there is one article on religion, three on the social order, four on the powers of government, two articles describing the regency and the education of royal children, and one final article on the armed forces. 11 articles in total, like I said, very short and compact. Article 1 acknowledged the Roman Catholic faith as the dominant religion, but at the same time, it guaranteed tolerance and freedom to all religions. Article 2 confirmed many old privileges of the nobility, stressing that all the nobles were equal and should enjoy personal security and the right to property. Article 3 stipulated that personal security, in Latin, neminem captivabimus, which is the Polish version of habeas corpus, this personal security was extended to townspeople, including the Jewish people as well. Townspeople also gained the right to acquire land, and they became eligible for military officers' commissions and for public offices, which were until that time not given to them. Membership in the nobility, the upper social and political class, was also made easier for the townspeople to achieve. Article 4 placed the Commonwealth's peasantry under the protection of the national law. It was a first step towards giving the political rights to the country's largest and most oppressed social class. The low status of the peasants, however, was not eliminated. The constitution did not abolish serfdom. In the political, economic, and social reality of those times, it was simply too early for that. Article 5 stated that all power in a civil society should be derived from the will of the people. The constitution referred to the country's citizens, which for the first time included also townspeople and peasants. This document in article from 5 to 8 introduced the principle of people being the sovereign in the political structure of the country. So not the king, but the people as the sovereign. The term sovereign applied to the nobility and townspeople, so not to the peasants yet. Those articles also introduced the modern idea of the separation of powers into the legislative, the executive, and the judiciary branches. With a bicameral Sejm serving as the legislative, the king and the guardians of the laws serving as the executive, those guardians of the laws, they were in effect a cabinet sort of governmental body, and the judges serving as the judiciary. Article 9 covered the procedures for regency, which should be taken up jointly by the Council of the Guardians, headed by the queen, or if there was no queen, by the primate, meaning the chief bishop of Poland. Article 10 stressed the importance of the education of royal children and tasked the Commission of National Education with this responsibility. The very last article of the Constitution, Article 11, concerned the National Standing Army. This army was defined as defensive force, and it was dedicated solely to the nation's defense. The army was to be increased in strength to 100,000 men. The 3rd of May Constitution was translated into the Lithuanian language, which by itself constituted a major change in the upper classes' thinking. It signaled the efforts to modernize the state, because up until now, up until that time, all the major documents were being held only in Polish. The constitution was also published in English, French, and German language editions. Now, simple question, why did this particular event come down in the books as one of the most important days in Polish history? The Polish-Lithuanian constitution of May the 3rd was the very first written constitution in Europe, and today we have already heard it a couple of times, and probably in the next material there will be also the information about that. So the constitution was only slightly younger sister, we could say, to the American constitution, which was adopted just 4 years before. Unfortunately, the constitution of May the 3rd was very short-lived. A little more than 1 year after its adoption, Russian armies, allied with some conservative Polish nobles, defeated Polish forces supporting the new constitutional order, and that brought the life of the constitution to an end. It provoked the final crisis of the partitions, which by 1795 had removed the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth from the map. Only after 123 years after World War I did Poland regain its independence. However, although the Constitution of May the 3rd lasted for only over a year, its establishment was a colossal achievement for the nation's political community. It was only then, in 1791, that the Polish people discovered that they constitute a political community. And that feeling has been carried on throughout the many years of partitions. And that feeling has made it possible for Poland to be reborn from the ashes. Thank you for your attention in this part of today's celebration. And now, after this brief introduction to Poland's National Day of the 3rd of May, let me introduce you to the most famous of the paintings depicting this very moment that you have just been listening about. The moment when the constitution has been adopted by the parliament and then carried on to the streets of Warsaw. This monumental painting has been done by the most famous national painter of Poland's historical moments, Jan Matejko. The occasion for that was the 100th anniversary of the constitution. Now, let's watch the movie about the picture together.
Duma Rzeczypospolitej. Jan Matejko, Konstytucja 3 maja 1791 roku. Obraz Konstytucja 3 maja 1791 roku powstał równo 100 lat po uchwaleniu ustawy rządowej. To przedostatnia wielka historyczna realizacja Matejki. Malarstwo mistrza Jana czerpie z głębokich i szczerych emocji samego autora. Miłość do ojczyzny, jej ludzi i spraw, w połączeniu z pracowitością i rozmachem, sprawia, że nawet dziś, w dobie filmu, efektów specjalnych i rekonstrukcji historycznych, wciąż myślimy i wyobrażamy sobie naszą historię tak, jak myślał i wyobrażał ją sobie Matejko. Autor Bitwy pod Grunwaldem i Stefana Batorego pod Pskowem świadomie wybierał najważniejsze społecznie tematy. Potrafił opowiadać historię z rozmachem i pasją, nie zapominając o szczegółach. Komponując postaci i gesty z kolorem i światłem, przekazywał publiczności to, co uniwersalne i ponadczasowe. Emocje, radość, gniew, niepewność, strach, odwagę. W obrazie przeznaczonym przez mistrza do sali sejmowej w Zamku Królewskim w Warszawie znajdujemy złożoną opowieść uchwyconą w niemal filmowym kadrze. Zakochany w polskiej historii Matejko przedstawił jej autorską interpretację, tworząc wciągającą opowieść o zmianie dla wolności, o triumfie rozumu, o odwadze i strachu, miłości, wierze i nadziei. Poznajmy bohaterów tej opowieści. Jest późne popołudnie, wtorek, 3 maja 1791 roku. Nasi bohaterowie właśnie przeszli z Zamku Królewskiego, gdzie ustawa rządowa została zaprzysiężona po raz pierwszy. Posłowie, odprowadzani przez radosny tłum, idą teraz ulicą Świętojańską do warszawskiej katedry pod eskortą królewskich grenadierów. Triumfujący Stanisław Małachowski, marszałek Sejmu Wielkiego. Drugi z marszałków, Litwin, Kazimierz Nestor Sapieha. Król Stanisław August Poniatowski. Architekci ustawy rządowej Hugo Kołłątaj, Ignacy Potocki, Adam Kazimierz Czartoryski. Jej zajadli przeciwnicy przyszli targowiczanie, Franciszek Ksawery Branicki i Antoni Polikarp Złotnicki. Poseł Jan Suchorzewski z synkiem. Poseł inflancki Stanisław Kublicki. Bohaterowie naszej historii Jan Kiliński, Tadeusz Kościuszko, Józef Poniatowski, Julian Ursyn-Niemcewicz i Stanisław Staszic. Przedstawiciele stanów i religii Rzeczypospolitej. Chłop, szlachcic, mieszczanin. Księża katoliccy, pop, Żydzi, a nawet święty, Czech, Klemens Maria Hofbauer. Mistrz Matejko przy całym przywiązaniu do szczegółu świadomie minął się jednak z historyczną prawdą. Wiemy, że w faktycznym pochodzie nie uczestniczył król, który do katedry przeszedł bezpiecznym przejściem łączącym ją z zamkiem. Na Świętojańskiej nie mogło też być nieżyjącego już wówczas prezydenta Warszawy Jana Dekerta, zamachowca Suchorzewskiego, ani przeciwników konstytucji, magnatów Branickiego i Złotnickiego. Dlaczego Matejko uczynił bohaterami swojego obrazu właśnie takie, a nie inne postaci historyczne? Dlaczego do upamiętnienia konstytucji wybrał właśnie przejście Świętojańską? Centralną postacią obrazu jest niesiony na barkach posłów ziem krakowskiej i poznańskiej marszałek Stanisław Małachowski, reformator i architekt ustawy rządowej. Patrzy wprost na nas, jakby świadom obecności publiczności, przyszłych pokoleń, obserwatorów jego triumfu. Paradoksalnie jest nieco nieobecny, jak kapitan zwycięskiej drużyny oszołomiony świadomością, że oto mecz się skończył, że wygrali. Radosny tłum oszalał z radości, ale co będzie dalej? Małachowski myśli o przyszłości. Czy uda się wykorzystać zwycięstwo? Jak zachowa się reszta drużyny? Tłum wiwatuje. Przeciwnik został upokorzony, ale czy pokonany? Czy zachowają trzeźwość umysłu, jak Hugo Kołłątaj, nakazujący powstrzymać oszalałego Jana Suchorzewskiego? Poseł ziemi kaliskiej, protestując przeciw zaprzysiężeniu konstytucji, rzuca się przed pochód. Chce targnąć się na życie własnego dziecka. Czy znajdzie się więcej takich, którzy jak inflantczyk Kublicki zachowają spokój w obliczu zagrożenia i powstrzymają rozlew krwi? A może koniec końców zatriumfują ci, którzy stoją teraz z boku? Branicki i Złotnicki, pragnący utrzymania status quo, żywotnie zainteresowani dalszym rozpadem i degrengoladą Rzeczypospolitej, pozornie tylko spokojni, tłumiący w sobie wściekłość, że oto dali się ograć, że kiedy ich stronnicy wyjechali na święta wielkanocne, reformatorzy zdołali przeprowadzić sprawny atak. Przyjęta dzięki chwilowej przewadze i taktycznej sprawności konstytucja znosiła wolną elekcję i liberum veto, wprowadzała trójpodział władzy i centralizację państwa, znosząc odrębności między koroną i Litwą. Kładła podwaliny pod budowę nowoczesnego narodu politycznego, nadając prawa mieszczanom i obejmując chłopów opieką prawa i administracji rządowej. Małachowski wygrał bitwę. Czy wygra wojnę? Oto późniejszy targowiczanin Złotnicki. Kłania się wyzywająco, patrząc na króla, jakby chciał mu przypomnieć o warunkach, w jakich ten uzyskał koronę. Stanisław August Poniatowski wie, że to od jego zachowania zależeć będą w dużej mierze dalsze losy drużyny reformatorów. Wie to matka jego dzieci, Elżbieta Grabowska, podobnie jak król i Małachowski, trochę nieobecna, myśląca o przyszłości. Córka prezydenta Warszawy Jana Dekerta, Róża, trzyma w dłoniach wieniec laurowy. nie w geście triumfu, lecz jakby zawieszony w półruchu. Matejko wiedział, jak potoczyły się losy bohaterów pochodu. Wiedział o tym, że trzeciomajowy triumf nierozłącznie wiąże się z tragedią Targowicy i rozbiorów, naszych powstań i klęsk. Wiedział też, że dziedzictwo 3 maja, niezależnie od konsekwencji, stało się faktycznym początkiem opowieści o nowoczesnym narodzie polskim. Prawdziwym momentem triumfu odwagi, rozumu i obywatelskiej miłości nie była bowiem chwila zaprzysiężenia ustawy rządowej przez Sejm złożony z uprzywilejowanej szlachty. Nowoczesna, demokratyczna Polska narodziła się dla Matejki na Świętojańskiej, pomiędzy Zamkiem Królewskim, w którym obradował Sejm, a katedrą, między rozumem a wiarą, przy udziale i wsparciu świadomego, zjednoczonego w wolności narodu. Stąd dobór postaci historycznych, których obecność podkreślała przełomowy moment w polskiej historii. Stąd obecność mieszczan z Dekertem, chłopa wciąganego do pochodu przez kanclerza Zamoyskiego, Żydów uczestniczących w zgromadzeniu, kobiet, duchownych i wojska. Matejko zakomponował tę chwilę narodowego triumfu świadom historycznych konsekwencji, ale zgodnie z duchem i emocjami leżącymi u podstaw zmiany, jaką niosły reformy. Małachowski z królem i reformatorami, zdrajcy targowiczani, bohaterowie insurekcji, mieszkańcy Warszawy, wreszcie sam Matejko mieli nie doczekać wolności. Ale wolność obudzona 3 maja na Świętojańskiej, wolność powszechna i demokratyczna, przetrwała. Pielęgnowana przez pokolenia jak płótno mistrza, przetrwała do dzisiaj. Duma Rzeczypospolitej.
So now that we all know a lot about this famous work of Polish art, let us also listen to a very special song. The song which was written in 1830 during the November uprising, one of the Polish uprisings against the forces occupying Polish lands. The song has been written to commemorate the enactment of the Constitution of the 3rd of May, and also to bring hope to Polish soldiers fighting for the independence of their country. The name of the song is Mazurka of the 3rd of May. But before we listen to it, as the last point of today's celebration, I would like to invite you all to the toast. So here is to the Republic of Poland, to the Polish people, both in Poland and all over the world, and to the good relations, friendship, and strong bonds between Poland, the People's Republic of China, and Hong Kong, special administrative region, our host in this part of the world. Cheers. Witaj w dniu 3 maja, który wolność nam zwiastuje.